Because they can do it as fast as they want to.
Yeah. Well, it makes perfect sense, and they've got enough resource to do it. It's just you keep thinking about what, you know, where is the best place for their resource.
Yeah. All right. So welcome, everyone. Saturday. Let me get my volume level here. Saturday, February 11th, Apple Cider Q&A meeting. While we were getting started, we were talking about Apple's new laptops. And there isn't any huge, compelling new thing about them, other than the touch bar, which is kind of neat, but we haven't seen a real killer feature for it yet. And so we're waiting for developers to take advantage of that. But the one thing I have seen, you remember Knight Rider and the kit with the little bar that runs back and forth?
Yeah.
Someone wrote a program to do that. So now you can have the little kit bar running back and forth on your screen while it plays the Knight Rider theme song. So that's kind of cute. And because it's, you know, thin is sort of the big new thing, let me make sure I get my setter. Nope, I got to change the name of my broadcast here. Because it's the hot new thing, and because it's so thin, seems to be the reason for its existence. Apple keeps making things thinner and thinner and thinner. That it uses the new USB-C ports on the side, which are a lot thinner than the previous USB-A's, which means if you have a lot of, let me see if I find a picture of it here, yeah. If you have a lot of peripherals, you may need to buy adapters to fit your old USB-A peripherals, you know, hard drives and printers and scanners. One of the sort of, I guess, counterpoints is that so much is wireless these days. You probably have wireless printing. You've got wireless internet. You can do wireless backup to your wireless hard drive. So quite a few people may not even need to have a wired computer. So it's, okay, sure. But there are still people that have a lot of wired stuff. And for the past year or so, since the USB-C Type-C came out, there haven't been that many peripherals using USB Type-C. But now that Google is using it on their Pixel, some of their Pixels, Lenovo is using it on some of their machines, so a lot of the PC world has started to use the new Type-C ports. We're seeing more and more peripherals come out. And all those same peripherals work fine on the Mac, which is kind of interesting because that's what happened with USB originally. USB is an Intel invention. It existed in the PC world for a couple of years, but no one ever used it because serial and parallel was just fine. And then in 98, when the iMac came out and it only had USB, suddenly there was a huge market for USB peripherals. And so the third-party company started making USB devices. And then it picked up on the PC world, and PCs abandoned serial and parallel, and everything is USB now. So sort of the same thing is happening with USB Type-C. Now there's a huge market of Apple users where that's the only connection, and more PC users are making USB-C devices now. So now there's a new market for you to do your peripherals. There is kind of a backlash in the high-end pro community that the MacBook Pro isn't really a pro machine. It doesn't use the latest processors because Intel hasn't released them yet. So Apple's stuck behind Intel's processor curve. Let me see if it's on the 13-inch too. On the 15-inch, you're limited to 16 gigs of RAM. Yeah, 16 gigs maximum RAM on the 13-inch also. And for a pro user, 16 is the minimum. And so Final Cut and even Photoshop and 3D modeling, a lot of these high-end programs, people will put 32, 64, you know, gigs of RAM in. So maxing at 16 is leaving out some of that pro market. But the reason they did that was because of the chip they're using, and low power memory. So to increase the battery life, they're using lower power memory. So lower power memory only comes in 8-gig cards. So this has 2 8-gig cards in it, basically. So, you know, next generation will probably go to 32 when the new chips come out.
Thoughts on
timing? Well, let's see what Intel's roadmap says. And the problem, no, it's not Sandy Bridge. We're up to Ivy Bridge. KB Lake is the next one. Yeah, so this is an old chart. We're on Sky Lake now and moving to KB Lake. And because Intel has been slow or had delays, where's the actual chart? Has had delays in getting the newer chips out, Apple is kind of stuck behind on some of the older chips, so they can't go as fast as they would like to. And that's one of the reasons, as I mentioned earlier, that the rumors are saying that Apple is going to make their own, this is still 2015, I want 2016. There we go, KB Lake. Apple's going to start making their own desktop chips. They already make the A series chips for the phone and the iPad, so maybe they'll make their own desktop chips, and that way Apple has more control over the engineering and how fast things will work, and won't be stuck behind Intel. And one of the reasons they shifted to Intel originally, when was the Intel change? That was System 10.6. They switched to Intel because IBM and Motorola weren't keeping up with the PowerPC line. It was lagging behind in speed, and it was using too much heat. So the G5 series, there was never a G5 laptop because it was too hot. And if you ever looked inside a PowerMac G5 and saw the giant, literally, you know, heat sinks, you know, 6-8 inches tall on the chip to keep the chip cool, then, you know, they never had a laptop version of it. And so that's one of the things that prompted them to move to Intel to begin with, is Intel had cooler chips. But now they're running into the same problem again, that Apple can't get any faster chips because Intel is behind in their developments. And some of that is because it's hard to make the chips go any faster. So, and we've seen in the last couple of years, the speed improvements have been marginal. You know, 10, 15, 20% maybe year after year. Or, well, not year after year, but chip after chip. And the biggest improvements have been in battery life. So you get 30 or 40% more battery life out of the new chip than you did on the old chip. So you can put more stuff in your computer and the battery lasts longer. So that's one thing nice about the new laptops is that they have these super long battery. If I get back to the spec page, the battery life on them is up to 10 hours of battery life. So, you know, that's a pretty long business day before you actually need to plug it in. So because of the lower power chips, that gives you the long battery life. So there's always this trade-off between battery life and performance. You can have long battery life or you can have high performance. You can't have both.
What about the change in the charging connection?
Yeah, so the USB-C that they're using for peripheral connection, USB-C is also available in higher wattage. You can do a 45 watt over USB. In fact, I think they're doing 60 watts on the 15 inch. That the USB port is now also the power port. So you don't have to have separate connectors, one for power, one for USB. And what's really nice on the 15 inch, it has USB on both sides. You can plug it in to either side. And that can be a deal for somebody. You know, my outlet's on the right, but now I have to run the cord all the way around to the left to plug in. And so that's an annoying little thing, but it's nice now with two ports, you can on each side, you can plug into either side if you want to. And USB-C has more in and out options. So right now, you typically think of USB as going out to a printer or out to, you know, a hard drive, but then the hard drive sends data back in too. And the, you know, like a webcam sends data in. So having more power and more ins and outs is going to make much more utility out of the port. So we're waiting to see what cool new things vendors are going to make out of USB, because you have more power available to you now.
I keep thinking about the number of times I've kicked the cord.
Yeah, the one problem is that it's not the MagSafe anymore, which was handy for not breaking the computer or yanking the computer down to the floor. But the USB-C, it's very similar in feel to the Lightning port on your iPhone and iPad. And it's not, I hate to say it doesn't stay in as tight, but it doesn't stick as much as the old style power cords used to. So there still may be a problem of tripping on the power cord and yanking it to the floor, but you're probably not going to have it plugged in as much because the battery will last so long. So it's only plugged in when it's on your desk.
Have you seen the improved battery life in your handling of it?
The first versions had trouble. There was a lot of press about the inconsistent battery life. In fact, it was a big mess with Consumer Reports. Was it November? Yeah, just before Christmas, they released, basically, they released a statement saying that we're getting really inconsistent battery life, so we can't recommend you buy one. And most of the tech press went nuts about them releasing crazy data. And the testing labs, you know, reported in on that saying, you're getting such crazy data, something's wrong with your testing procedure. And it turned out, yes, there was. They were turning a developer mode on to test the computer with, and there was a bug in the developer mode. So they actually uncovered a bug that Apple then fixed, but they were in developer mode, and average users don't go into developer mode. So their testing methodology was flawed. But because that made the headlines, Consumer Reports says don't buy a Mac, which isn't what they said. They said they can't recommend the Mac, because they have recommended Macs since then. It wasn't a don't buy, it's a not recommended. Subtle difference that the press all got wrong. But that was it. So then, like in January, they issued another statement. So what they were finding, sometimes the battery lasted 3 hours, sometimes it lasted 18 hours. And with such a radically wide range in results, something is wrong with your testing, or something is wrong with the computer. It's not normal. And so then later on they said, yeah, it was the developer mode and this bug. And so Consumer Reports said, yeah, we found a bug and Apple fixed it. And Apple said, there was a bug in the Consumer Reports data was wrong. but there were the couple of bug fixes, a couple of updates, and so now the battery life that we're seeing for most of our customers is very good. We did have one customer return his that he bought day one because he didn't want to wait for the fix to come out. So and that's what we'd been saying all along, is there's a problem. It's either going to be a software fix or a hardware fix. Either way, you're going to get your computer working the way you want it to work. But he returned it anyway. Okay. Then we were stuck trying to sell a used computer that was so new. Because you can't sell it as new anymore. Once the customer opens the package, it's used. But we haven't had any complaints since the updates came out.
Other than the memory limitations, everybody's been living with the drive capacity and everything.
So that's been a trend the last couple of years. When they came out with the Retina models, the first Retina models, I switched to flash drives. And so the storage drive is smaller than it used to be. You know, this laptop has a 750 drive. And so when this model was out, it was 500, 750, and a terabyte, because they're spinning mechanical drives. Because this was the last model before Retina. when the Retina models came out, they went to flash drives for speed, thinness, because it's thinner than a mechanical drive, and battery life. They use less battery. But they're much more expensive at the same capacity. So now we're down to 256 and 512 are the standard storage devices. And the jump from 256 to 512 is significant. And so say, let's take this one that has the 512 in it. If we want to take that from 512 to a terabyte, $400. Where a 1 terabyte spinning drive is $80, $90, no big deal. So they're much more expensive for the solid state drives, but they are really fast. And so it makes your computer run really fast, which can overcome the lack of speed improvements in the processor. Because now you've got such a fast hard drive that the computer boots in 10 seconds, you know, applications open, less than one bounce. We used to count how many bounces it took. And now new people don't even know the icon does bounce because they click on it, it bounces once, bounces half a time, and the app is already open. But it used to be you'd have to count. In fact, there was a video some guy put out, and I'll probably never find it again, but he was playing music and got the icons to bounce. All his icons in his dock would bounce in rhythm to the music because it would take 10 or 15, 20 bounces to get a program to run. So the going to bigger drives, and in fact, let me go back on the 15-inch. There's an option for a 2-terabyte drive, and that is even more ridiculous. So if we go up, a 2-terabyte drive is $1,200 more. Well, that's a whole second computer if you want. And uncharacteristically for Apple, they kept the previous generation computers in the product line. Typically what they do is a new model comes out at the same price the old one was, and then the old one drops in price. Didn't do that this year. The new models came out at a higher price. So that's another annoyance the internet is complaining about. And the old models are still available. And they can appear to be faster, especially in the 13-inch. So the 13-inch is a 2 gigahertz processor for $1,499. So it's 8 and 256. If we go down to the previous generation, you get a 2.7 for $1,299. But it's only 128 storage. So if we take that and go up to the same 256 storage, air storage, now you're at $1,499. So for $1,499, you can buy last year's 2.7 model, or you can buy this year's 2.0 model. Last year's model has the old ports. So if you have a lot of peripherals, you may want to buy last year's model. Part of the problem is the new processors are more efficient than the previous model, so they don't have to run as fast. So the 2.0 processor is actually about 10% faster than the 2.7 because it's a newer chip inside. And Apple, for a long time now, has not emphasized the clock speeds of their computers, because clock speed almost doesn't matter anymore, unless you're comparing the same computer with the same specs. So there's a 2.0 and a 2.9. So the 2.9 will be, you know, 30-40% faster than the 2.0, because it's almost half again more speed. But comparing this year's 2.0 to last year's 2.7, in fact, I probably have that comparison somewhere, because of the internal changes on the chip, the 2.0 can be faster than the 2.7. And they're also using a newer, faster storage interface, so your storage drive is even faster. So the 2.0 can end up feeling faster than the 2.7, which doesn't make any sense. Yes.
Still true?
There is a finite number of read and writes on an SSD, more on the write side of it. Because when you write data to an SSD, it damages the SSD a bit. All right, so let's go early 2015. It is the 2.7. We'll check on that. So there's a feature called wear leveling that the operating system automatically does. So when you write data to the disk, it doesn't write it to the same spot again and again and again, which wears out that cell faster. It scatters your data around the disk. The hard number is something like a million writes, which generally you won't run into. But if the wear leveling didn't happen, you would notice your drive wearing out a lot faster.
That it wouldn't mark those bad cells.
Right. And you'd watch, so some of the older SSDs, you'll see that. You'll see the capacity drop without adding any data because cells are getting marked as bad and removed from use. In fact, we're even seeing some of the SSD drives are coming as more capacity than they were. So like a 512 drive that used to be 512 gigs, we're now seeing being advertised as 525 to give you more slack, so when the cells wear out, it's not as critical a thing for you.
So in a nutshell, how has it been received?
By the average folk, very well. The touch bar is cool, and it's only the sort of the real high-end niche crowd that doesn't like it because of the limitations.
So they're going to wait. You think they'll wait for the next iteration of chips?
Probably.
Or go
somewhere else. I've actually started seeing a bigger surge in Hackintoshes that we hear, which is basically you buy generic PC hardware and run macOS on it. It's a little tricky because you have to get the right hardware to get the drivers you need. But you can often save 20-30% by buying generic hardware and building the computer yourself. There was one I just saw where a guy, what was it? He built a $900 Mac Mini clone of what Apple would have been $1,300. And he can run bigger monitors than Apple did because Apple uses a different video card. The Mac Mini, being such a small computer, you can't fit very much stuff in it. So the guy who did this test, he bought a bigger generic case. He still wanted it to be small and pretty, which it was, but it was a bigger case so he could put a bigger video card in it. But he ended up spending less and than an Apple would cost, and it tends to run perfectly well. It's just he had to jump through hoops to get the right hardware. One of the things he said they had to do is he had to take the wireless card out and put a Broadcom wireless card in because Apple uses Broadcom. So the drivers are already built in. So you can make a Hackintosh, but you have to be really specific about the hardware you buy, because it has to be close enough to the hardware Apple uses.
And that's all documented, so if you're shopping, you'll make sure you get the right
machine. Yeah.
With the right chipsets.
Yep.
Okay.
And there's a class of people that just like building their own computers anyway.
Yeah.
Just to tinker with it. And a neat thing we're seeing now these days is like the Raspberry Pi. $35, you get a computer and put whatever case you want on it. You write your own programs for it. You download programs that other people have written. It really harkens back to the early days of the Apple II, where you bought a computer and there was nothing with it. If you wanted a program, you wrote it yourself. And that was part of the fun, is learning the programming language and learning how to make your own programs. And it's really cheap to do now. Well, it's we never know what cool thing they're going to add next. You know, you can generally expect the processor to be faster. The camera will probably be better. Right now on the 21-inch, only the high end is a 4K model. So they'll probably make the low end the 4K model now too. As parts get cheaper, they can move down. So basically Apple typically now has a good, better, best.
Yeah.
And when the new model comes out, the base model falls off, And the better one now just becomes the good, and the best one becomes the better, and they make a new better one. And so they just shift everything down the line. Last year, all the 27s went to 5K. The year before that, only the top end model was 5K. So last year, all the 27s did. So I can see this year, all the 21s going to 4K, which is the retina screen, basically, for the iMac, so that you get that super high quality. All right, let's see. The 2.0. Where were we? So the 15-inch. No, if I'm on 13-inch. So last year's 13-inch Retina. Early 2015. Used the Broadwell chip. So that was the previous generation. So the 2.7 benches out at 34. So if we go to this year, 13-inch. 2.0 using the Skylake chip. So the 2.0 benches at 35. Let's see what the multi-core is. 69 multi-core versus 64. So the 2.0 is faster than the 2.7 because the internal architecture of the chip is faster, more efficient. And the biggest difference is a smaller die. I don't know if this will tell me the die size. So the smaller the die, the closer the traces are together, and that means that the electrons don't have to go as far. Bless you. So we actually are running into speed of light propagation delays. Speed of light is too slow. The electrons moving through a wire are going too slow. So the one way they do it is they make it smaller and smaller and smaller. So I think we're down to 15 nanometers now, and moving smaller. How would I do? What's the chip size? The die size. Die size. So they're getting smaller and smaller chips, which means you can get more chips out of the same silicon wafer, which makes the price smaller. Smaller and smaller and smaller. So let's see. And it's not going to tell me what I want to know. All right, yeah, die shrink. So how fast the dies are shrinking, which gives you more. Yeah, so some of the early chips were 250 nanometers, and now they're pushing 5 nanometers.
Yeah.
In 1971, it was 10 micrometers, and now we're pushing 5 nanometers. In fact, there's a great video. Let me see if I can find it. Grace Hopper, Amazing Grace Hopper. Has this video out that she taught in class on wasting nanoseconds. That when you're programming, how much is a nanosecond? Because that's how fast computers were working. All right. Skip the ad, please.
They started talking about circuits that acted in nanoseconds, billionths of a second. Well, I didn't know what a billion was. I don't think most of those men downtown know what a billion is either. And if you don't know what a billion is, how on earth do you know what a billionth is? I fussed and fumed. Probably one morning, in total desperation, I called over to the engineering building, and I said, please cut off a nanosecond and send it over to me. And I brought you some today. Now, what I wanted when I asked for a nanosecond was, I wanted a piece of wire which would represent the maximum distance that electricity could travel in a billionth of a second. And of course, it wouldn't really be through wire. You're out in space, velocity of light. So if you start with a velocity of light and use your friendly computer, you'll discover that a nanosecond is 11.8 inches long, the maximum limiting distance that electricity can travel in a billionth of a second. Finally, at the end of about a week, I called back and said, I need something to compare this to. Could I please have a microsecond? I've only got one microsecond, so I can't give you each one. Here's a microsecond. 984 feet. I sometimes think we ought to hang one over every programmer's desk or around the neck so they know what they're throwing away when they throw away microseconds. Now, I hope you'll all get your nanoseconds. They're absolutely marvelous for explaining to wives and husbands and children and admirals and generals and people like that. An admiral wanted to know why it took so damn long to send a message by a satellite. And I had to point out that between here and the satellite, there were a very large number of nanoseconds. You can explain these things. It's really very helpful, so be sure to get your nanoseconds.
Speed of light seems fast until you have to get anywhere. So in an amazing coincidence, a nanosecond is about a foot, 11.8 inches. So the distance light can travel in a billionth of a second is about a foot. And so a microsecond was about 100 feet. And a lot of science fiction stories, when they talk about traveling, time is distance, distance is time. So you think speed of light is fast, but it takes 3 days to get to the moon. It takes 9 months to get to Mars. And suddenly, it's slow. You want to send a radio communication to Mars? That's 40 minutes. And it's terrible. Speed of light drag is a drag. So some of the better sci-fi stories will take that into account, where there's a speed of light delay and the time it takes to get from one place to another place, and it's really interesting when they bring that into the plot, that it might take us 6 weeks to get from this outpost to the other outpost, but a light will take maybe 2 hours, and so we can communicate, but we can't physically get there any faster. So Grace Hopper was an amazing person. That's one of the reasons she's been nicknamed Amazing Grace. She actually, it's probably in her Wikipedia article, she coined the term bug in the early computer. She's one of the very earliest computer pioneers. And she just died recently in 92. Let's see, where's the picture? So there she is at UNIVAC, one of the early computers. And there, in her notes, the computer was malfunctioning because there was a bug in it, drawn to one of the vacuum tubes, and so she removed it, put it in her log file, and replaced the vacuum tube. So there was a moth in the relay preventing the computer from working. So she found the first bug in a computer, and it literally was a bug. Have you seen the Hidden Figures movie? Really interesting, specifically focusing on the black women that worked at NASA during the moonshot, and the mathematicians, their work. Katherine Johnson was one of the most famous mathematicians, and she had to get over the fact that she was a woman and black. And that was a huge no-no in those days. And there was this whole, what they called the West Computing Group at Langley, was all black women. They wanted to help and serve their country, and they were good at math, but the whole thing was so segregated at the time. And one of the things I've read is that NASA wasn't that segregated. Had pretty much integrated everybody by then anyway, and in fact Katherine Johnson and who was the other Dorothy Vaughan became the first supervisor of the IBM 7090 computer because she recognized the computer going in was going to be doing so many calculations, it could do 100,000 calculations per second, that all of the girls that she was overseeing were going to be out of a job unless they learned the computer. And so she took a lot of the girls that she was working with, taught them Fortran, and got them jobs, you know, basically running the computer. And in the movie, she actually fixes the computer and gets it working, because her daddy taught her, you know, basically mechanical engineering at the back end, fixing stuff around the house. But so the movie takes place during the Apollo 11 in 61, was it? But she actually was named the supervisor in like 59. So they sort of condensed some of the events together to make it more dramatic. But they were, you know, instrumental in the development of the early space program because they had the math. And so the engineers knew the engineering, but they were inventing so much stuff along the way that it was tricky. And the pressure the Russians were putting on us by beating us in so many ways, you know, first orbit, first the dog in orbit, Laika, first man in orbit, first woman in orbit, and it was just so far ahead of us that there's a good line where the head of the program was saying, I can't believe they are smarter than we are, so they must just be working harder than we are. So, you know, call your wives, you ain't going home tonight. and so when some of the declassified documents came out, it wasn't that they were working harder than us, it's that they took more risks than us. And there were a lot of early disasters that never were made public. But it's a really interesting movie. And there was there's a TV show, Timeless, where they go back in time and they're chasing the bad guy who goes back and changes history. So that's always sort of the backstory is when they come back to the present, what's changed. They went back to NASA, and they've got a soldier for security. They have a woman historian, and they have a black engineer who's the pilot of the time ship. And it's like there was a couple episodes where the woman, I forget her name, she's complaining about every time they go back in time, she loses her status, basically. She's a woman. So, you know, look pretty, sit in the corner, don't talk. And then the black guy says, you're complaining? The only job I have is the slave, the servant. You know, yes, man. So in one of the episode where they went to NASA, he remembers Dorothy Johnson as, you know, an inspirational black person. And they run down to the basement to the computer and get her to fix the problem the bad guy created. And then there was another episode where they go back and meet the Lone Ranger. Oh, shoot, what was his name? And the Lone Ranger was black. And so Rufus, the character, goes, oh, my God, the Lone Ranger's black. That's awesome! And then there's a line about, you got to tell your story because some dick in the future will make you white. what was his name? Bass? Nah, I'm not gonna find. There we go. Bass Reeves. Yeah. He is credited with. That's not gonna find. Credited with over 3,000 arrests. Only killed 14 people in self defense. That was a plot point in the TV show that he wouldn't kill Jesse James. He wanted to take him in alive, because you don't kill unless you have to. It was an amazing story about this man in this time. But he still had a problem with women. He wouldn't let the woman come along on their posse. There's no place for a woman. And then she went on to put on pants. Oh my God, a woman in pants. That's, what's going on? So it's kind of neat watching some of these shows and looking up the history on it. And so he was a marshal, and one of the inspirations for the Lone Ranger legend. There was an episode where they went to Germany during World War II. It was a Christmas party in this castle, and Wernher von Braun was there. And there's been some interesting allegations recently about how pro-Nazi von Braun was. When we rescued him, he's instrumental in our space program. But in Germany, he appeared to be pro-Nazi because they gave him money to launch his rockets and to do his research. And so during this Christmas party in this castle, the evening's entertainment was they launched a V-2 at London. And so I look it up, and yeah, that really happened. In fact, there was a lot of... No, argument's not the right word. But in the early space program, von Braun had this whole plan about a space station, moon shot, and then a moon colony, and then a Mars colony. And when the Russians launched their satellite first and Kennedy did the whole let's go to the moon, that whole plan was scrapped because we have to go to the moon first. And a lot of people think that's the reason we haven't left Earth orbit in 40 years. If we'd have had a space station earlier that you could use as a construction and launching platform, we'd be farther along than we were. But in the technology of the technology of the day, it was a better idea, that, and he eventually agreed with it and worked toward building the Saturn. Big ass rocket.
Center when you go through the graveyard
of the thing. Those are incredible pieces of work. And they have one lying down at Kennedy where you can see all the different sections. I just saw what's his name? Kai Michelson I fly model rockets. And it's always the big thing about making the next bigger rocket and how high can you go and how fast can you go. Kai Michelson is the record holder for the highest, Michelson, Rocket Man, there we are, is record holder for the highest amateur rocket launch. He actually reached space, and he won one of the X Prizes. He got a rocket over 60 miles. He puts a rocket on everything, basically. He just posted a link on Facebook. He sells ballistic parachutes now. See if I can find it. Someone else just built the largest amateur rocket. It was 50 feet, 1 inch tall. No, this is not it. That was only 36 feet. Although that's pretty impressive, too, a 36-foot Saturn V replica. Steve Eaves, probably. Yeah, Steve Eaves. 1/10 scale Saturn V. So that's 1/10 scale. It's 35 feet tall. And one of the things is kind of amazing about it. Come on. Full screen is unavailable. All right, we'll do it this way. Come on. Come on. Just a long one, yep.
I am ready.
Looks like and sounds like a real rocket. It is a real rocket.
Thank you.
Then you got to get it back. That's the second half, is getting it back.
Yeah.
I've been watching all the videos of the Everest climbs.
Mm-hmm.
The K2 climbs. Their whole schtick is getting to the summit is only half the battle.
Yeah. And he stuck the landing. It stood up on landing. So that one got eclipsed by a 50-foot rocket. No. Here it is, ULA. So United Launch Alliance, which is one of the actual rocket companies these days, they had a bunch of interns that, and they had some high school kids that were involved on it. They put a bunch of projects. They had 19 projects built in. They have a better video somewhere else. So 50 feet tall. Where's the better video I found? It was on Kai's website. Let me see if I can find it. Showed some of the deployment. Fort Carson, there we go. It showed some of the deployment of the amateur pods and the experiments going out. It's one of those that takes years to plan, put together, and build. All right, are you going to play? Play.
The Elsir Chevrolet source is 720 Chevrolet.
And we got to go through the ad first, of course. Yeah, it was Army base in Colorado that they launched at. It's actually two-stage. The bottom fins came off, and then the next stage ignited. So the motors I launch on are $20-$30 each. Get some of the bigger motors, you're, you know, 100, 200 each. One of some of the biggest ones that they fly in our club are about $500 for the motor. Wow. Launch a 20-foot rocket, you know, a couple hundred pound rocket. So you don't launch them very often because the motor.
Participate in the thing that's held at Geneseo.
Yep. Yeah. Yeah.
Yep.
And that's how we started. We started just going as a spectator, and then one year we won a rocket in the raffle and sucked us in ever since then. I'm going to go for my level one certification this year so I can fly the bigger rockets.
What do you have to do
that? Launch a rocket successfully.
So it's proof by doing?
Yeah, you build it, you launch it, you recover it, and if you do the whole thing successfully, you get your certification. So the rockets are by letter. So the smaller model rockets that the kids fly are, you know, A's and B's and C's. Every letter is 10 times more power. So I've been doing mid-power rockets, Fs and Gs. Gs as high as you can go without certification. So the level one gets you to H, I, and J. And then you have to go to level two to get above J. And at level two, you can make your own fuel. So it can get cheaper that way by making your own fuel. But it's really dangerous to make your own rocket fuel.
What is the fuel?
It's ammonium perchlorate. It's the same thing the shuttle uses. Okay. The solids, you know, it's the standard for rocket boosters. It's fairly stable. It's pretty easy to mix. You just don't get it too hot while you're mixing it. And then there's level three, which is the largest rockets, O's and P's, to get up into the real high ones. So some of the guys will launch a giant rocket, but only go up 1,500 feet, so it comes down pretty close. There's the Mach Club for people that try to break Mach 1. The Mile High Club to break a mile. At Geneseo this year, we're actually going to go for we've got a 12,000 foot waiver because the population density is so high and the school's right there. So 12,000 feet's the most we can go. Usually, they don't go that high because you don't want to lose it.
Yeah.
Generally, what happens with something like that is something called dual deployment. So the rocket goes up. And at Apogee, a small parachute comes out just to stabilize it. And then the electronics on board don't launch the main parachute until 1,000 feet or so. So it comes pretty much straight back down again. But if your parachute comes out too soon, it can get blown away and drift for miles. There's another club out in Penyan, in Potter, that they're in the middle of nowhere, so they have a 20,000-foot waiver. And I've been to a few of their launches where some of the guys are pushing 18, 20,000 feet. And they've got GPSs now that transmit back and speak to you. So they've had altimeters, so you can when it comes back, you can check to see how high it flew. But now they're actually putting GPS and radios in them, so the GPS reads back to you the flight acceleration data and speed and altitude. Yeah. In fact, I have a program that I use called Open Rockets, a free version, open source. There's a commercial program called RockSim, where you put in the model of your rocket, and in fact, they generally have most of the rocket kits people have already modeled, and so you tell it what motor you're putting in it, and it will give you an estimate to the height, and it will calculate the G loads. And the altitude and the speed, because you have to measure the delay in ejecting your parachute, because you don't want the chute to come out too early, but you don't want it to come out too late either.
Yeah. Do you have a date for that event at Geneseo?
Yes. Do they have? I know they had it on their Facebook page. They have a launch every month, but the big one they do is New York Power. Does she have the new date up yet? Yeah, May 27th. Is that Memorial Day weekend? Last weekend in May. Yeah, May 27th.
Why is it listed 3 days? Is it going on 3 days?
Saturday, Sunday, Monday, yep.
Okay.
So Monday must be Memorial Day. No, yeah, Monday's Memorial Day. So they're usually Friday, Saturday, Sunday. But since Monday's Memorial Day, they're doing it on Monday too.
Okay.
They're doing a night launch. It's probably Saturday night. We did one last year, and I was too scared to launch. You put lights on your rocket so you can find it again, and I was too scared of losing it. But then, in retrospect, I'm sad I didn't do the night launch. I should be able to get to my photos. So they do a launch pretty much every month. At that site.
Okay.
The New York Power is just sort of their biggest one. Rockets. Actually, I should probably find. Their power. I think it's named. Oh, that's. See if that comes up again. There's some of the. Let's see, those are all video. So one of the problems in taking pictures of rockets is they go so fast.
Yep.
There's my son in his our first rocket. So that was 10 years ago. So that sort of sucked us in, and you always want to go to the next bigger rocket, the next bigger rocket.
Yep.
So I'm flying one now called the Red Max. Oops, it's about 40 inches tall. And so this guy has an upscale version of it. So even bigger.
Okay.
So the bigger they are, the bigger your motor is. I think, is that mine? No, that's not mine. Somewhere I have a favorites list of the rockets. So there's mine. And this should be a video, yep. And they go so fast you lose it in the.
Yeah, I remember doing one of the cameras that I got does 15 frames a second. So
yep.
Trying to catch it and pretty soon it's out of view.
My camera has got a 4 frame per second burst mode, so it's 3, 2, 1, launch, hit the shutter, and I almost always miss it, because is it late, is it early? But sometimes I got some perfect pictures where it's your 4 shots of it getting high.
Yeah, yep. I've got steps of it where you watch ignition, and you can see it literally.
Yeah.
How do they ignite? Is that electrical? Just a
yeah, electric igniter, yeah.
Is it heat?
Yeah, it's nitrile wire. And the smaller rockets use black powder, and then the bigger ones use the ammonium perchlorate. So it's that instant, that instant heat ignites the main propellant charge.
Okay.
If
you'd like a change of topic.
Sure.
Let's talk about video editing on demand.
Okay. Well, iMovie is the program the Mac comes with. Does pretty much everything most people need. In fact, we're sort of seeing a trend now where people don't edit much anymore. That was the big thing for years: is you edit your photos, edit your video. So Apple threw in the iMovie and the iPhoto, and now it's more throw it to Facebook and that's it. But iMovie is a really cool program for doing pretty sophisticated video edits. And if you want to do something even more, you can move up to Final Cut. That's sort of the pro version.
That's the $300.
Yeah, yep. Okay. And it used to be $3,000, so it's down quite a bit. Yeah.
Wasn't there a big stink when they released that they had stripped out?
Yeah, the new version 10 didn't have all the features that version 7 had. On a bit. So we almost wish they'd have called it something different. But all of those features have been added back in since then. But at the time, a lot of people abandoned Final Cut and went to Adobe Premiere, and also running Windows, because Apple's the power Mac and the Mac Pro have languished behind in performance. And even now, the Mac Pro Cylinder that was introduced with such fanfare, and Phil Schiller said, "Can't innovate my ass," because all the blogs were saying that Apple lost its mojo and couldn't innovate anymore. That's been 4 years and hasn't been updated. So yeah, it was great 4 years ago, but now it's ancient. The chips are old, the video cards are old, and because it's not a generic tower, you can't replace the components in it like you can do easily on a PC. So a lot of people shifted to Premiere on a PC and just sort of ignore the fact that it's running Windows, because you're just running Premiere in it. Which is interesting, because before that, it was Avid on custom workstations. You know, you'd spend $1 million putting together a video studio. And then, you know, for $100,000, you could put together a Final Cut studio with, you know, four bays and four different Macs running Final Cut. And so, because Apple didn't keep up in the very high end of the pro world, that some of that got lost back to Avid and Adobe.
Okay. Now, the lease programs for Adobe and their cloud programs, they've got Premiere in there for editing.
Yep.
And then all the add-ons for the special effects.
Yeah, Adobe After Effects is the typical effects plugin for special effects. A lot of that's built into Final Cut. They have a separate program called Motion for motion graphics. Apple.
Okay.
You know, so Final Cut and Motion are sort of a companion program together.
Okay.
Adobe has some interesting plans. They've got a Photoshop and Lightroom for $10 a month, which isn't too bad, or $20 for a single app, or if you want all the apps, it's $50 a month. They don't have a video bundle. So photography, Photoshop and Lightroom is great, but you know, say you want to do Premiere and After Effects. So then you gotta pay for two, so now you're at $40 a month. You might as well go to $50 a month and just get all the programs. So you get Photoshop, Illustrator, you get all the print, you get all the web, you get all the video. They used to have separate bundles, where there was a print bundle, a web bundle, and a video bundle. And then the Master Collection was $2,500 to give you everything. So at $50 a month, that's 2 years to get the $2,500, and that's about what Adobe's production cycle was. So every 2 years, they'd come out with a new version, and so that was one of the complaints about the Adobe suites is, you know, every 2 years I got to spend $2,500. So a lot of companies would skip a year. So every 4 years I spend $2,500. But now, at least Adobe says they haven't released. I don't think they've released their actual sales figures. But Adobe says that they've got the subscriptions are very popular, because $50 a month is palatable, without thinking of that, you know, that's, you know, $600 a year, and then you have something to bill your clients against too. So if you can charge them for the production suite, include that in the cost of what you're billing to your clients. They have free trials available, so if you want to play with it, you can. Then Avid Cinema is the other major video editing suite. Mac and Windows. Almost everything is Mac and Windows. But generally speaking, Windows hardware can be cheaper, and it's more upgradable, so businesses like it better as an investment. So, you know, you spend a couple grand on a computer this year, and then next year you put a better video card in it. The year after that, you put a better processor in it. Where in the Mac world, you're stuck with what you buy, and you have to replace the whole computer. And even in the Mac Pro, where the video cards are replaceable, Apple used the 7-inch format instead of the more common 10-inch. So finding video cards to fit don't work. So even though the Mac Pro is kind of upgradable, no one can upgrade it because there aren't the cards that will fit in it. That's one of the reasons why the Hackintosh communities, especially at that real at that high end, because you can get a much more powerful computer. Although sometimes, have you seen the Microsoft Surface?
No.
The Surface Pro is everything an iMac should be, but isn't. It's a 27-inch desktop computer that it looks like an iMac, but the whole thing's a touchscreen. And it angles up and down. Not Surface Pro, Surface Studio. So the stand has basically hinges on it, so you can lay it down like a tablet and draw on it, and then raise it back up again, you know, like a traditional computer. And the whole thing is a touchscreen, so it's everything that a lot of people wish the iMac had. It's expensive though; it's $3,000. But to get it configured like an iMac, it's $4,000. So the iMac is cheaper, but it doesn't have the touchscreen. So it's one example where it's a really cool machine, but it's really expensive for a PC. And there's, you know, the hinges that that let it turn like it does. Remember the iMac G4, the half dome with the screen that went up and down? There was some amazing engineering in those hinges. So you could lower the screen, and it didn't change the angle of the screen. It just changed the angle of the arm. It's one of those hidden engineering things that people didn't think about. But the Surface Studio is basically, it's a laptop. In the that base at the bottom is the computer, and then the screen just raises and lowers up and down on top of it. And it's got a pen, it's got a stylus, so it's got everything that people want to see on the iMac, the high-end graphics people. So now they'll get the Wacom Cintiq, you know, a 23-inch touchscreen, plug it into their Mac as a second monitor. So it's a touchscreen monitor that lets you do all of this with a Mac. But that's another $3,000 or $4,000 on top of the Mac. Let's see, I should be able to find the versus iMac. So it's one case where the iMac is a better comparison. They had a video of it. Except for the touchscreen. Most PC lines have a touchscreen option these days. Let the video go that said it had. So most PCs have a touchscreen option, but the Mac doesn't. And so the touch bar on the new Mac Pros is kind of the first stage to going to a full touch screen. And the usual argument is that people don't want to dangle their arms on the touchscreen. Well, yeah, but it's nice. We don't want to do that, but maybe we want to tap the bold button or take a stylus and draw on it. So it's interesting where, in this case, and it's a Microsoft-branded product, but it's expensive compared to generic PC. One of the reasons PCs are so cheap is they're such a generic box, a generic ugly box. In fact, when we were building custom PCs in our office, the chassis was $15 for the case. And it had a 15-day warranty. If it breaks, throw it away and buy a new one. And the difficult thing in PCs is that we'll sell a company, you know, PCs if they need it, and then, you know, 3 months later they come back and want more. The one they bought don't exist anymore. Because the PC companies change so fast. that you can't buy the same thing again. Now, you, and you look at that, you know, say HP's website, you know, I want to decide, oops, just on just one company, and it's the same for every company. They make, oops, HP.com, they make 50 different models that are slightly different than it. So it's really good for people finding the computer, the exact computer they want, because there's 50 different models. But if you're looking, that's not what I wanted. If you're looking for a computer, and you go to one of these websites and you're inundated with 50 different models, you know, how am I supposed to know what I want? Yeah. So they've sort of got it broken down. So they have seven categories. Apple has two categories, desktop and laptop. In fact, that was one of the big things when Steve Jobs came back to Apple. He cut down on all of the different product channels and SKUs. So there was the Quadra series that was sold in computer stores. There was the LC series that was sold to schools. There was the Performa series that was sold in Sears and department stores. And all the computers were slightly different than the other ones, so you couldn't compare them with each other. So Steve cut all that down to four computers: desktop, laptop, pro, consumer. So sort of the classic, you know, four grid that he introduced. We've kind of gotten a little beyond that now. There's quite a bit of overlap between the pro and the consumer, which is the complaint on the new MacBook Pro. It's not a pro computer because you can't upgrade it the way you used to be able to upgrade pro stuff. But, you know, the other companies, so I don't, well, you know, what's an immersive computer? Well, I don't, you know, what if I want something cheap? So I don't know what any of these are if I want. So let's say I want a tower. So now that we're in towers, I've got, you know, all these towers, and that's, you know, page one. Load more, okay. So what's the difference between the $899 computer, the $649 computer, you know, the $399 computer, the $558 computer? How do you decide which one you want? So it's people that come into our store that have trouble with the three models: good, better, best. We kind of joke with them that if you look at the PC world, hi, oh, I guess we forgot to sign in, didn't we? In the PC world, you've got 100 companies, and each company makes 100 models. So it's even harder to figure out what you're doing.
10,000 permutations.
Yep. And you come back next month, and they're all different. In fact, there's a big criticism, especially on the Dell website. You look at a computer in the morning, you go back in the afternoon, and the prices are different. There's deals at this time, and there's different deals at that time. And you tell your friend to look up this computer, they get a different price than you're getting on your computer at the exact same time. It's I don't know how PC businesses stay. Well, and one of the things they do is you go to Best Buy, and they have a different range of computers. Then you go to Walmart, and it's a completely different line of computers from the same company. So you can't compare prices. Well, Best Buy's got this computer for $399. Well, Walmart's got a different computer for $399.
Well, some companies give lower quality products to Walmart to sell there than if you went to a higher grade store. Is that true with what you're talking about?
Pretty much, yeah. So generally speaking, you can have cheap or you can have good. And so, yeah, Walmart will get the cheap computer. $299 for a cheap computer. It breaks, you throw it away, buy a new one. And it's frustrating when people come into the office with one of these, you know, $300 computers, and you tell them it's going to be $200 to fix it. Well, might as well just buy a new one. Yes, you should. Because the new one you buy now is going to be, you know, better than the one you bought 6 months ago. You go to Best Buy, you'll often see the cheap ones, but you'll also see the good ones. And if you go to, you know, higher end store, you'll generally see the better models. They're built better. They're made from longer lasting components. So the $399 computer is the real cheap component. So it's going to break sooner. You pay $99.99 for a computer, it's going to last longer.
Now, without Circuit City, is Best Buy the best place to get the higher quality other than in the Apple Store?
That's pretty much the only place these days. Yeah.
As Best Buy,
yeah. I think Staples, Office Max is gone, but Staples is still around.
Office Max film only in Victor. They still existed and we had it by Southtown.
Oh, did they? Okay.
It was the landlord.
Just the Victor one?
Wanted to raise the rent unconscionably, so mm-hmm. we decided to leave. And so what was Office Max is now going to be TJ Maxx.
So they don't have to buy so many letters for their sign? Now, ironically, not ironically, interestingly, that the Best Buy in Victor doesn't sell Macs because they're too close to the Apple store. So I got Apple's got some deal with Wilmerite.
Does TJ Maxx sell Macs?
No. but we used to have a store in Eastview Mall. And when Apple moved in, we got kicked out by our rent being tripled. Because Apple has this deal with the mall owner that they don't want competition in the mall. So every now and then, and Jackie knows the Wilmerite family. So Wilmot family, yeah. So she went to, was it Danny? One of the guys that she knows, and said, well, you know, let me have a store. All right, how about I put an iPhone case store? No, can't do that. Well, there's a kiosk there that sells iPhone cases. Yeah, but they're knockoffs. They're not real. So Apple can't force them because they're not the brands that Apple sells.
Well, except for Tiffany's, I understand that Apple has more sales per square foot than any other.
I think they're higher than Tiffany, too.
They're higher now?
Yeah.
So they're a prime tenant.
Yep. So they have that power in a mall to do that. Yeah, they're double Tiffany.
Oh. Well, that's changed then.
Yeah.
Because they make them in China.
And I think some of their raw materials are probably cheaper. yeah, $5,000 a square foot. And that was 2014. Let me see if I can change my search to find something newer. How about in the last year? So that was $5,300. So in 2 years, they've gone from 47 to 53. No, this is 2011. But I said in the last year, why did you find something? Now here's May of 2016. 5 days ago. But when I went to this article dated 5 days ago, the article is dated 2011. That could be. Or there was a comment that got posted recently. I hate that when people comment on four-year-old stories and it pushes it to the top of the list again.
That may not be an accident.
Yeah. So here's 2016 where it's 55. So from 2014 to 2016, it went from 47 to 55. Yeah. Oh, who's this Murphy that's ahead of Tiffany?
Shoe store?
It's not Murphy Beds, is it?
Murphy's shoe store is high quality shoes. That's Johnson and Murphy, though.
They're green, so another jewelry store.
Oh.
I'm sorry, Tiffany's green. You know, a gas station. So a gas station makes a lot of money because gas is so expensive.
I wonder what brand gas they sell.
Let's find out. Yeah. Oh, Walmart. Located in proximity to Walmart's. Now, the gas station in Irondequoit, at the Irondequoit Walmart closed. We noticed last month when we went to the board meeting. In fact, it's more than closed, it's gone.
Well, Sam's Club has their own gas stations.
BJ's does too. I figured that's probably why Walmart did it. So, yeah, they don't have anywhere near here. Not a lot of them to be that. Well, it wasn't total sales. It was sales per square foot.
Yeah, right.
So one gas pump with two sides on it, that's one square foot. Yeah. Murphy Oil in 2013.
23 U.S. states.
El Dorado, Arkansas. So they intentionally opened it near Walmart. Yeah, so where there's a Walmart, the Murphy gas will pop up.
But they'll be bargain seekers and they won't want to pay much.
Yeah. All right. Any other question? Rick. Location services? So location services will tell you what programs are requesting your location. So iCloud.com/find will take you right to Find My Eye. Back to system preferences. There's the Find My Mac setting. No, but laptops you could leave behind somewhere accidentally or get stolen. So let's see if I log into my account. Yes. Oops. You can see where all the devices are you've attached to your iCloud account. Yeah, so there's my computer and there's my, no, my home computer and my iPad. There we are. Yeah, so Find My Mac will turn location services on for your Mac and publish it to iCloud. So if you misplace your Mac, you can log into iCloud and find where you left it. I was probably on a previous meeting. We were showing it off and I left it unchecked.
So if it's checked, and now you uncheck it and you go to sign out,
we get a lot of strange messages when you sign out of iCloud anyway. Wants to know it's what to do with the iCloud data that you have on your computer. Sign in with your password. When you sign out of iCloud, it's going to ask what you want to do with all your data, and generally it's delete the iCloud data from the computer. The iCloud data, yes.
Right, but that's in case that you don't expect to get it back. You think it'll be compromised.
Right.
But you really don't want it.
And the iCloud data will stay on iCloud, so you can get it back if you log back in.
Oh. You delete it from what's on the desk on the computer.
Yeah.
Okay.
Some of the stuff you can keep on your computer. Some of the stuff it will delete from your computer. I don't know. So here, iCloud Drive, contacts, and photos I can keep. The next screen, I don't want to sign out. The next screen will tell you the things it's going to delete.
Oh, it does.
So whatever's not listed there. Calendars, probably, which isn't listed. Bookmarks, maybe.
You mentioned calendars.
Well, hang on just a second. Finish Rick's question. No, it doesn't say you want to delete your account. It's asking if you want to delete the data from your computer.
No, I don't want to delete the data from my computer.
Then don't sign out.
I want to leave it on. I want to sign out and leave it on my computer. Why can't I do that?
Because it's iCloud data. It's stored in iCloud. It's not on your computer. It's on iCloud.
Then why does it refer to the data on my computer?
Because it's synchronizing it from iCloud to your computer. So if you're the whole purpose of iCloud is to sync data to your computer. So if you sign out of iCloud, obviously you don't want it on your computer anymore.
I just find the message confusing. I think they could have done a much better job.
Do you want to keep your data before signing out? That seems pretty easy to me.
Is there something you click to do
that? To sign out of your account.
But with still keeping the data though before you sign out.
You click the Keep Data button.
Oh, there is one.
Yeah.
I guess that's what you're...
On this first... here are all of the services that iCloud synchronizes, all the information. So some of them you can keep, some of them you can't. So it looks like Drive, Contacts, and Photos I can keep. The next dialog... I don't want to remove that stuff from my computer, so I don't want to sign out. So I don't sign out.
So you're always signed in?
Yeah.
Doesn't that seem wrong?
No, because I always want to synchronize my data.
Okay. See, I don't ever want to synchronize any of my data.
Then you never should have signed in the first place. The whole point of iCloud is to synchronize your data.
Yeah, but then when I get in there and I set everything so that I don't want to keep anything, I go to sign out.
Then it's going to delete all the data that you've been synchronizing.
And I think on the iPad it's even worse. It asks me if I want to delete my account.
No.
No.
It never asks if you want to delete your account. You cannot delete your account. Even if you want to, you cannot delete your account. You can abandon it, but you can't delete it.
All right. Thanks.
Mm-hmm. All right, so you got a question on calendars.
Yes, the iCalendar, if a notification was called for, the whole calendar pops up and takes over the screen. And that happened to me once when I was in the last few seconds of bidding on eBay, and I was blocked from the eBay.
You're running an old OS, because that doesn't happen anymore.
Oh.
You get a notification window.
Okay. And the other problem is that when that calendar pops up, it asks me to synchronize with Dudley's email account, which I'm not using at all, but I've got to click twice on that drop-down before I can get rid of that, before I can do anything.
You have to sign out of his account on your computer, or it's going to keep asking you.
Okay. But apparently I'm in that account, and so I don't have to sign into it to get out of it. But
it's asking you for the password because you are signed into it.
Yeah.
So it wants the password to synchronize. So if you don't want it to synchronize, you have to delete that account from the computer.
So I have to enter the password and then sign out.
Maybe. If I go to accounts and say delete.
And that's what I was afraid of. I don't want to delete his account.
You're deleting his account from your computer. Yes,
only from my computer.
You do want to do that.
So he still is able to use it from his computer.
Well, of course.
Oh,
yeah.
Okay. I didn't want to create a problem.
So they've added something called Internet Accounts. So in your system preferences, there's now Internet Accounts. So instead of managing your calendar accounts in calendar and your mail accounts in mail, they've sort of unified all that into one system preference called Internet Accounts. And so that's where you tell it your mail accounts, your notes accounts, your calendar accounts.
I'm not using Apple Mail. I'm using Gmail.
Doesn't matter. And Gmail is a service. Apple Mail is a program. So you can use Gmail, the Gmail service, with the Apple Mail program. Excuse me. So the internet account shows you your list of accounts. And if you want, you can. So what you want to do is find Dudley's calendar account in that list and remove it from your computer.
Oh, it's his calendar account, not his email account. Okay.
Well, it could be both. But you said in the calendar program.
That's where it shows up for me, yes.
If it doesn't show up in your email program, then you're not setting it up for email.
Okay.
So some accounts you can have multiple services.
Because I think the word email was in that drop-down.
Yeah. So, like, here's my Jesse Group account. I have five different services I can synchronize. And so you can choose which one of those services you want and which ones you don't by the checkbox. And if you don't want any of those services, you can delete the entire account from your computer.
Okay, but it does ask me for the password, which implies that I'm not signed in, but you think I am signed in.
You're not necessarily signed in, but it's signed up. So it's the account is on your computer. It wants the password to synchronize because you've told it you want it to synchronize.
Okay.
So by putting the account in your computer, you've told it you want to synchronize.
Yeah, I'm concerned you get spam, and I don't want anything to do with spam.
Everyone gets some sort of spam. That's one of those unavoidable things in life.
Well, he opens things that I wouldn't.
That's the bigger problem. This one I actually got this week. I was gonna talk about it at the meeting Wednesday, but forgot. This is fake, but it looks really, really real. Couple of ways I know it's fake. It came from a weird address. It didn't come from Apple. It came from a Papple. and it's got other company logos on it that Apple wouldn't have. And if I point to one of the links, it's telling me it's going somewhere else. So t.co, that's actually a Twitter account. And if I point to here, it's saying apple.com down in there to sort of trick you, but it starts with t.co. So that's where that link is really going, to t.co. It's not going to apple.com.
It's Trump's Twitter account.
Yeah. So it's the fake messages are getting to be much more real looking and much trickier to figure out if it's fake or not. Rick?
I lost my calendar up to time. Personal calendar. Next thing I know, I disappear. But yet I find I'm still getting notifications from that calendar. So I think that it somehow got sucked up into the iCloud.
Is it an iCloud calendar or is it a computer calendar?
I had set it up as a computer calendar.
And then when you turned iCloud on, it became an iCloud calendar.
Maybe that's what happened, but I've told it since. I don't want anything out of the iCloud.
So you have to sign out of your iCloud account and delete all the iCloud data.
I thought I'd done that.
If you go into your calendar app, it will show you where that calendar exists. So this calendar is on acider@mac.com, so that's an iCloud calendar. If the calendar is only on your computer, it will say, my computer.
It doesn't even show up in that list anymore.
Then it might be disabled in your preferences. You might have to re-enable it. So if I enable my Jesse Group calendar, then it's going to show up now in the list.
Okay, what preferences are you enabling now for your
calendar? Yep. So now my Jesse Group calendar shows up. Are the notifications coming from email or from the notification manager?
It's coming from the notification manager.
So the account still exists in your preferences somewhere. So you got to check your calendar preferences and your internet account preferences.
It up and it was gone.
It would have asked for your iCloud ID and password to make it an iCloud calendar.
It probably did when I was originally setting the thing up.
Yep. It's an assumption on Apple's part that when you turn iCloud on, you want your data synced, and so it pulls everything up to the cloud. Yes, we'll add my calendar notifications. There was a problem, last month, with calendar spam. When you make a new calendar event, so let me just say new calendar. No, I don't want to do that. I want to actually drag an event. So say make a new calendar event for today. One of the things you can do is add invitations by email address. So I can say Rick, and here we go. So now Rick will get invited to this calendar event, and he'll get a notification in his calendar that this event is created. Somebody figured out how to do mass calendar invitations. And so a lot of people were plagued by calendar spam, advertisements for sunglasses and for mortgages and stuff like that were showing up as invitations in their calendar program. And the default is to automatically, accept invitations. Or is that under general? No, where is it? Yeah, something in the alerts. So you automatically get, if someone sends you an invitation, it's automatically added to your calendar. And so for a few weeks, people were getting calendar spam until Apple fixed it at their end, probably putting the spam filters on the calendar links. And for a lot of people, your calendar invitations also came in email. So you might have seen the calendar notification in your email as well as your calendar program.
Yeah, I was getting imposed on my calendar some product a couple of months yep. ago, and I couldn't figure out how to delete it. It just would not delete, and it went away, and haven't had anything like that. And that's what you're talking about.
Yeah, so Apple fixed it at their end, closed that loophole someone figured out on how to send mass emails.
And they did that without asking me to update the system.
Yeah, they did it at their end. They stopped the invitations from coming to you. I don't know if I don't think I got any on this calendar. I did get some on my personal calendar.
If I want to delete something on my calendar, I've not found how to do that except in recurring events where I, instead of continuing to recur, I just click stop on date.
You click on it and hit the delete key.
So I just highlight the event and then hit delete.
Yep. If it is a recurring event, you can choose to delete just that one instance of the event or all of the events.
And it gives me the choice on the drop-down.
Mm-hmm. So January 4th is solar perihelion, our closest approach to the sun in our orbit. So the middle of winter is when we're closest to the sun. But we're tilted away from the sun. So the tilt, axial tilt, makes more of a difference than distance to the sun. Right, because the southern hemisphere is pointed toward the sun, they get a cumulative effect. They're tilted toward the sun and they're closest to the sun.
Did anybody here see the comet from the dawn hours this morning? It looked like it was overcast clouds where I was.
Yeah, it was too cloudy. In fact, yesterday was a huge astronomical day. There was a ISS Passover about 7:30.
Passover.
Passed over us.
Oh.
The lunar full moon penumbral eclipse and the comet. So there's a telescope in England called SLOW, where you could watch it happening.
Oh, I didn't know that.
If it was if it wasn't overcast there. Let's see. There we go. Watch now. Yeah, I don't want to log in. I just want to see the video. So they had the snow, yeah, the full moon. So now it's a waxing crescent because it was full yesterday. Let's see, moon.
Yeah, could we go back and see it?
Maybe. There we go. When was the actual... Yeah. That storm that never came last night. So now it's a waning gibbous at 98.9%. Let me go back to the slew. So the next event is in 14 days. Ooh, the Southern Ring of Fire solar eclipse is in 14 days. Yeah. So a solar eclipse in the south. Let's see. It's what Kevin shows at his party sometime. He's got an account with him. I bet Sky and Telescope will have pictures and videos. There we are, the comet. Comet 45P, which I half thought for a second was the one that Rosetta landed on, but that was 65P.
What's P stand for?
The name of the person that discovered it. So let's go back to the... A green comet. Pajovsky?
Okay.
Pajovska. Kafka.
Pajoskova,
yeah. So 51,000 miles an hour at 3 a.m. Eastern time.
Sounds like a superhero, the green comet.
Yeah. So that's the big thing. Are they saying, why is it green? What elements are in it that are fluorescing green? Yeah. Yep, naked eye visible. No, I'm sorry, it wasn't named. The P doesn't mean the discoverer. It's the 45th periodic comet to be calculated independently by three observers at the same time. So all three get the credit. Interesting.
There's also a website I've seen over at U of R that runs regularly showing all of the earthquake activity throughout the world.
Probably USGS, maybe.
More than that, it's live throughout the world.
Mm-hmm.
And it's amazing. There's constant in the earthquake activity that you just never hear about.
Yep. There's so many earthquakes so often. Yeah. The Ring of Fire. There's an app for the Mac. I don't know if it's been updated in a while, called Seismic. And ages ago, must be utilities. There it is, Seismic. When did it come out? 2010 is when I got this version. Apple added a motion sensor to the computer, and one of its first jobs was to sense if the computer fell, and it would spin down the hard drive and park the head. So when the computer hit the ground, your hard drive would be safer. So a lot of enterprising programmers figured out they could use this motion sensor to do other things. And the USGS commissioned this program called CSMAC. And so if there's an earthquake, or you know, hit it this way, what's interesting is how sensitive this is. You know, I just tap it, and there's a bump in the graph. And so the idea was that the more people who ran this program, the better they could measure earthquakes without putting in expensive seismometers everywhere.
Because of the triangulation.
Yeah, and they could have 1,000 seismometers, you know, in around an earthquake and letting it run on your computer.
Well, that's what they do for telescopes when they're able to raise that
up. Yep. And so it was kind of neat. Just the tiny vibrations on a table are visible. Yeah. Yep. There's an exploit that will do that. Yeah. It uses the sensors in the phone, measures the vibration of the table, and the typing frequency, based on letter frequency and word frequency.
Because each letter is hit differently.
Yep.
Because of the different fingers.
Because of the different fingers, and the letter frequency in words. So they know what words are being typed, and it was like a 70 or 80% reconstruction of what was being typed on the table.
So if they still had internet bars, you could really find out what somebody else is typing.
Well, now you go to like Starbucks, and someone's sitting on at the other end of the table. You put your phone down, you can watch what they're typing almost. No, there's another exploit for that. Wi-Fi interference. If you want to get really scared, listen to the Security Now podcast on the Twit network, where they talk about all these security exploits. There are many antennae in your phone to pick up signals from cellular, from Bluetooth, from Wi-Fi. The position of your fingers on the phone will change the antenna reception and the antenna transmission. And someone figured out a way with relative results, you know, good results, of how to figure out what you're typing and where your fingers are on the screen by the Wi-Fi signal interference changes.
The capacitance change that does this?
No, the radio. Your phone is broadcasting a radio on Wi-Fi.
Okay.
And your position of the finger changes.
Oh, it's interfering with the broadcast signal.
With the broadcast signal, yep.
Capacitance change.
Right.
Okay.
So they can figure out where you are just by the position of your fingers. Mm. 68% accuracy. So there was an old exploit for like ATMs, where in fact it was almost unnecessary. They'd use a thermal imager to see the heat of your PIN, and so they could tell what your PIN was by the thermal differences in the four characters. But it's easier to sit across the parking lot with binoculars.
Yeah, so you could defeat that if you had a way to reprogram the keyboard layout, because it's not a touch key system.
Mm-hmm.
And you could have the letters in randomly different places.
Well, the thing you can do, at least in the winter, is use gloves, and then the heat difference is negligible. Or what I've sort of gotten in the habit of doing is when I'm done typing my PIN, I put my whole hand down on the keypad to change the thermal pattern on the keys.
You're talking about the gloves that have the ability to still use the touchpad.
Well, most of them now aren't touchpads. They're still physical buttons.
Which
is a little annoying, because a lot of the ATMs, there'll be a touchpad where you do some stuff, but the physical button they have to do for other stuff. And I'm wondering if that's a security measure of some sort. Needing to use a physical button for your PIN, but to tell it how much money you actually want to take out, you'd use the touchscreen.
Right, right. If it's one of the denominations given on the touchscreen, but if it's a different one, then you use the
keypad, yeah.
But I was told one way to watch out for these is if you see two reflections on the monitor screen, because that tells you that somebody's added a transparent screen that can pick up
More likely, it's a pinhole camera sitting up above the ATM screen somewhere, watching the touchpad. Oh. Or there's a new skimmer. You're familiar with skimmers? It's a thing that the bad guys would put over the card slot on an ATM. So you put your card through their skimmer before it goes into the real ATM slot. So a lot of people know how that works now. So there's a new type of skimmer that fits inside the ATM. And so you don't even know it's in there, except the card's a little harder to put in and out. But if it's not your routine ATM, you may not know that, may not realize that.
And that applies to the old ATMs and the secure card ATMs? Your card stays in there during the transaction.
Yeah, your card stays in during the transaction, and so the skimmer inside of it can read the chip too. So theoretically, they can collect your chip data and then write their own chip card. So the mag stripe on the back of your cards has been a security problem for years, because it's very easy to write your own mag stripe. So if someone gets your stripe, they can write their own and make their own credit card of you. So the chip is supposed to make that harder. And it does, and you have to buy more expensive equipment to reproduce the chip. But that still can be done.
It's not a one-time only thing like Apple Pay would be, though.
Right. Yeah, it's not one-time only. The chip is an added security layer on the card, but it's static information.
So this particular skimming would not affect the Apple Pay situation.
Right. The Apple Pay uses NFC talking to the register with a one-time number, so it's much more secure than the other types of systems.
What did those letters stand for? NFC?
Near field communication. So it's a very short range radio that's supposed to only work within a few inches.
Oh, okay.
Although we have heard problems of someone, like the next person in line behind you,
yeah,
their card gets read instead of your card.
Oh, I'll have to do that.
The one story I read is the woman was looking through her purse to figure out which card to use, and the guy behind her already had his card in his hand, ready to go, and so that's the card that got read. But it's only supposed to be a couple inches. He was feet away.
No, that doesn't have the same problem.
Usually the opposite problem is that you can't get close enough to it.
Yeah.
You almost got to lay it on.
They might have turned down the power on a lot of them because of that, yeah.
No, your bank card will not have the same RFID problem that driver's licenses have, will it? That it can be read by somebody nearby unless it's...
I don't think it is RFID. I think it has to be physical contact.
Well, I can hold my... I guess the iPhone near the Redmond's register.
Because it has an NFC chip in it, yeah.
Okay.
So if your card also has Tap to Pay, then it's got an NFC chip or RFID chip in it.
Okay.
That's a separate service than the chip that you can see.
So the cards that I have that... to use for tapping, that's something that sends out a signal that can be picked up, that should be shielded instead?
Yes, it sends out a signal. It is supposed to be only a few inch distance. But if someone has a big enough antenna, they can pick it up. Yeah, you're getting close enough, and it's supposed to be faster than putting the card in the reader. So the one problem now with the chip readers is it's a lot slower than the swiper. And so a lot of retailers don't like it. In fact, Wegmans just now turned on the chip readers. They've had them for, 6 months?
It's March, I thought they were turning them all on. Some of the stores do have
it. Some of the stores have it on now, yeah. But what's interesting, because if the card has a chip and the vendor doesn't use the chip reader, the vendor is liable for fraud. So you'd think the big companies would want to go to the chip as soon as they can.
But they're fighting that now, and they think the new administration is receptive because it's hurting business.
Because it's slower. It takes longer to get through the line, so you can't put as many people, so you lose your dollars per hour.
But it's the difference of 9 seconds versus 4 seconds.
Ten or 15 sometimes.
Well, according to the Democratic article a couple of days ago.
Part of the issue, I think, is isn't Wegmans got a thing where they're going to pre-approve it, so it's actually going to start reading, you're going to put your card in before your sale is done?
Well, you can do that now.
Okay, but then it's going to start processing, and then all it'll be is a total.
Because you're used to, you know, swipe your Wegmans card, shove your credit card in.
Yeah.
You don't wait for the prompts. The problem now is you've taken it out too early, you got to start over.
Right. But that's not the case with Wegmans.
With any of the chip readers. If you take the card out too early, the transaction is canceled.
Chip readers.
Yeah.
Okay. I just use Apple Pay now.
Yep.
It's more fun.
Yep. All right, we're just about done for today. One last question.
Expand a little bit on Steve Gibson and the security now, your thoughts on it. Are there other things like reading Krebs on security?
Who's the other guy? There's Brian Krebs and who's the squid guy? Where's my security? I don't have my personal computer. I've got all my bookmark links. Krebs and the other guy.
Anybody remember Maynard G. Krebs?
I think, it's Krebs. It starts with an S, but I can't, it won't come to me. Bruce Schneier, that's the other one. Schneier on security. Yeah. And he's got his Friday Squid blog, where every Friday he posts a message about squid for some reason. I tend to see Steve Gibson brings it a little more understandable. And especially with Leo hosting it, Leo kind of translates sometimes too. If it's too complicated, Leo will often translate it or have Steve reword it so it's a little more understandable. There we go, Friday Squid blog. So squid communicate through skin patterns, colors on their squid, squid color patterns. So that's the color fluctuations on there. So there's been sci-fi stories about aliens that communicate through color patterns. So I guess that's happening here too. That's a nasty thing to say.
Okay, so between the three, the Krebs and Schneier are too high end.
Krebs and Schneier both do a pretty good job of bringing it down. I like listening to Gibson a little more than reading Schneier and Krebs. I tend to feel that sinks in better.
So is he at the same level, do you think, or is he, or is he just grabbing the more popular, explain it?
He is a little bit. He is more of a. He's a Windows programmer and a hard drive guru with SpinWrite. He'd really. Deep into how hard drives work so he can fix them. But he's gotten more into security with his squirrel project he's writing. He has come up with a replacement for passwords, the secure, quick, reliable login. And since passwords are so often lost or breached or people make them too simple, he has developed this system for the last like 2 years. They've been working on it, and it's pretty much ready for implementation. That you put you've got a QR code on your phone, and when you go to log into a website, it shows a QR code. You put your phone up to and the camera looks at the code, compares the two codes, and authenticates you and logs you in. So it's there's no password that can be lost. It's a 256-bit code, so it can't be easily guessed. So a lot of companies are trying to figure out some way to replace passwords for authentication because it's such a broken system.
Yeah, and all the news email, you have a link to change it if you forget it.
Right.
You know, the email.
That's one of the things with Squirrel. If you forget your password, you're screwed.
Yeah.
You can print out, I forget how many pages he said it was, which is your code, but you know, heaven help you trying to type it back in again.
Well, it's like LastPass giving you temporary.
Yeah.
Save.
Yep.
Save if you need it.
Yeah, and then the Security Now podcast, audio or video, really great keeping up on what's happening in the security world. He also did a really good series on the fundamentals of computers, where he started with a register and a flip-flop and a NAND gate, how computers work. And that really helps with understanding how things work.
Cool.
Yeah, thank you. Let me quit all my stuff here. And I remember Soundbites, Saturdays from 12 to 2 for questions between meetings. And we'll quit all this stuff down. And I will shut down the stream. So thank you all for coming.
Thank you. See you next time.